pleasure to be glad that you chose to be in church this morning. Let's rise and go to the prayer. God, I want to thank you for this day, this beautiful day that you have given us to enjoy with our families, with our friends, with our church family. We thank you for all your many blessings you have given us this week as we go forth into this next week. We thank you for this service. We give it to you, God. It is in your hands. Take it from us because it is not ours. We give it to you. We ask that your will be done in each and every way that possible can be done here today. Take our worship, receive it. Take your glory and your honor. In your holy name I pray. Good morning. Can we say praise the Lord together? Praise the Lord. Can I say about the sovereignty and omnipotence and the power of our God this morning? Try to put it this way. Majesty. Majesty. Worship His majesty. Have you come to worship? Have you come to worship? Lift your hands and wave at it if you have. Amen. Let's sing it together.
Kingdom of the Lord. Oh, we are your baby, I listen to a lot of music. And the songs that I sing, I feel like it's the songs that God lays on my heart. It's not just something I just go in the store or I just look at it and I choose. I feel like God chooses me to sing these songs. This one has been a very difficult one. And we have, for months, just tried and tried and tried. And it may not be perfect, but I know that God gave me this song for us to sing. And I just pray that you will listen to the words and that God will touch you through this song. And it's called God is in this story. God's not just in my story, but He's in each of your stories as well.
Words that tell me I'm no good, chapters that define me for so long. The hands of grace and endless love dusted off and picked me up, told my heart that hope is never gone.
Keeping it to yourself. He meant for you to share both the highs and the lows. You're meant to share them all with each other, and that brings glory to Him. And it's kind of odd how in our modern understanding of church, we kind of think of it as a place just to reach out. But honestly, if you look at the early church, they didn't really need the service to reach out to those that were lost. The people's lives were a testimony of Jesus Christ. That's what drew them in to wanting to know Jesus Christ. It's not a manufactured thing, but it was just revealing of the lives. And so as you reveal your life, both in worship and just encouraging one another. We do know that word, don't we? That's a biblical word. Encourage one another in the Lord. Anybody need encouragement? Have needed encouragement? Yes, we all need encouragement in the Lord. So either the Lord does it outside of you, or He does it through you. I think He would rather do it through you. So let's praise His name. I have had a little bird told me, I believe somebody's got a birthday today. Miss Drenda Butler has a birthday today. So happy birthday to you. From all the 96 family, we celebrate you and hope you have many, 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 many more. Thank you. Children's Church. You sending her to Children's Church? Children's Church needs to go. Absolutely. If your Children's Church is assembling, so if you want to go there, please go there now. Let me also announce, tough one for me, but it is that season of the year. We're going to have a service in the next couple of weeks or so. But Saturday, June the 3rd, Kirsten Bria Brock will be graduating from high school. So for those of you who didn't hear my sermon about this, I did want to. I'll post this on the back so you can see it. It's really nice. The scripture that was that they chose for this year. It comes from Matthew chapter 5, verse 14 through 16. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand. And it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. That is prophecy fulfilled. That's the only way to say it. And next weekend, we will not be here. The Reverend Ben Rushton will be taking care of you both Sunday morning and Sunday evening. He will do a good job with that. But we will be at a leadership conference because she wants to learn how to affect people for Jesus Christ. And so she's gathering a whole bunch of other Christian influencers, whatever that means. I'm way too old to even go into that word. But she just wants to make a difference. And she wants to learn how to do that. So you can pray for her and pray for us as well during this time. I also wanted to make a quick mention. We do have bulletin coming out. Give Miss Joyce your information by today or tomorrow. Make it easy for her so we can have that out for next week. And benefits. We had a benefit yesterday. That's amazing. I just want to say, we've had two major events here that I've never seen at this church, but I just think the church has handled itself so well. Much to be thankful for, much to be proud of. So I want to thank Tommy, Heather, Chris, and all those who cooked, all those who cleaned, all those who set up, all those who tore down, all those who parked, all those who did tons of things yesterday to cause them not to tear up this property, but it went officially. And can you give us a total or an outcome of yesterday?
We raised right at
$6,000. $6,000. Can we just praise the Lord for that? This church reaching out, because again, this is what we celebrate today, what God has done during the week. Thank God we could do this. Thank God for the response. I don't assume the response. I'm grateful for the response, and I'm thankful that we can bless the McDonald family in that way, joining with this community as just one community. What a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful thing it is to see that. Okay, do I have anything else to say? I don't believe anything else other than prayer workers, which means whoever gathers for on Sunday night tonight, we will be praying tonight, focusing on prayer tonight at 6 o'clock. I guess I can mention, because it was official yesterday, our bishop. Ray Boggs has gone back in as our bishop, as well as all of the executive council, or the executive council that has been, they have gone back in for another season, so We thank God for his leadership. Thank God for what he's doing in our denomination. Not only giving, they highlighted our giving, but they also highlighted how much this conference, this particular part of the International Pentecostal Church Conference is blessing the world. And we're sending out, we're not sending just money, we're sending out missionaries. So we highlighted the Bridges Museum, and also Reverend Elaine Dimsdale, who's also not only representing our conference, but also our church, and she's going to be ministering to the people of Belize. Praise God.
Amen.
I've always said, judge the church by your ministers and your missionaries, not by anything else, because that's the most important thing. God didn't say raise tons of money. That's necessary. It's helpful. Ms. Delane will take anything you've got left over and in addition, because she needs to get there. Get her out of here. I've got other missionaries that are coming doing the same thing, but he says go. That's what we've got to do. And if we got people going, working, doing, praise God for them. That shows well on our church. Would you please stand as I read from Mark today? We've been looking at the gospel according to Mark chapter 1. Jesus beginning, showing who he was. What a small book, but what an impactful book in Jesus showing us himself. We take a lot of this stuff for granted, but as we take time to focus on it, I believe we see things that are truly dynamic and meaningful to us. Mark 1, beginning with verse 40. Jesus has been ministering. He's not only been confronting evil. Still got any mama bears in this room? Oh, I've gotten quiet all of a sudden. Have I got any mama bears in the room? Okay, I thought I did. I was pretty sure that I did. So, we still confront evil. But we don't confront evil the way the world confronts evil, do we? Sometimes it is confronted as we see in Mark chapter 1, verse 40. A leper came to him. A leper is. Just think a disease where you've got to put on a mask, you've got to put on a thing. You know, when they have to do that in the hospital, especially during COVID, man, they head to toe, you had to go all crazy because there's so much potential illness there. Well, lepers like that in the ancient world. You don't want to be around them. You don't want to breathe their air. Their flesh is probably rotting. You just don't want to see it. You don't want to be around it. In fact, they weren't. You weren't supposed to get near to them. But a leper came to him. He didn't stay where he was supposed to. He invaded Jesus' space and his ministry space. He came to him begging, imploring him, kneeling down to him and saying to him, if you are willing, can make me clean. Jesus, moved with compassion, stretched out his hand. Remember what I just told you? Disgusting. It's icky. It's ugh. Moved with compassion, stretched out his hand and touched. What a powerful picture. And he said to him, I am willing. Be clean. As soon as he had spoken, immediately the leprosy left him. Boy, that's a wonderful little passage there. Too many people get defined by their ailments, don't they? He was called a leper. He wasn't a leper. He was a man with leprosy. God didn't make a leper. He made a man. Leprosy came on him, and Jesus said, it's time for the leprosy to leave so that the man can live. So the leprosy left him, and he was cleansed. He strictly warned him and sent him away at once. Said to him, see that you say nothing to anyone. Go your way. Show yourself to the priest and offer for your cleansing those things which Moses commanded as a testimony to them. However, he went out and he began to proclaim what Jesus had done freely. Spread the matter so that Jesus could no longer openly enter the city, but was outside in deserted places. And they came to him from every direction. Almighty God, I ask that your word be applied to the needs of our hearts today. God, we are not whole. We are needy. We are not complete. We need you. It is by grace we are saved through faith. We bring nothing but a belief in you to the table, but you bring grace, justification, restoration, wholeness, healing, and hope. So God, thank you for what we have in you. Apply this word to our hearts that we may be the people of God as you define it. And we thank you for that great grace today. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. I want to talk about the push and the pull that we see here in the latter part of Mark. Mark is showing us, as I said, Jesus' ministry, but we think too much it's straightforward. Did this, did this, did this, did this, did this, check it off, done, the end. There's nuance. There's some reality that pops up through all of these things that helps us not only to grasp the story, but to understand its relevance to us. Because it doesn't matter to us. That's why God gave it to us. He didn't say, look at this neat little story. He's not treating us like children in children's church. Children in children's church need to learn these stories. They need to know them deeply. He's not treating us as needing to just know the story. He wants you to apply the truths of the story. This is for you, for your story, for what you're going through. And so here we have a passage where Jesus has been confronting evil, but he also has to deal with the effects of the curse and of evil on this world. And in this case, there probably could be no better picture of sin or no greater sickness or ailment of that world that was so disgusting nobody wanted to do with it, to the point was if anybody came near to you, you were to scream out unclean so they would never get within your vicinity. Can you imagine what that does to the psyche? Can you imagine what that does to your heart when you literally can't embrace your family or your loved ones, but you have to tell everybody you're worthless, you're unclean, you are just fit for being outside the city in your own little camp with dying people that are dying in the most horrible manner? It's an earthly picture of a hellish existence. That comes to Jesus. What's Jesus going to do? Jesus listens to him. And I want you to look at it both from Jesus' perspective. I don't want you to look at it from the man's perspective. From Jesus' perspective, he sees him coming to him. He does not rebuke him. He does not say, why are you disobeying my Father's law by coming within vicinity of clean people? Why are you doing that? Jesus said none of those things. It says, once he heard his imploring, if you are willing. And I love this language, don't you? Because there's other people that come to Jesus. Do you remember when he went up on the Mount of Transfiguration, came down, there was a man with a demon-possessed son. He came to him. His question was a lot different. He said, if you can do anything, heal my son. Now that offended Jesus. What do you mean, if I can do anything? He showed he didn't believe he was the Son of God. He didn't believe he could do nothing, no matter what he's heard or what he's seen. You ain't touched my son, so you can't be the Son of God. If you can do anything, then heal him. Jesus said, it's not if I can, it's can you believe? Very different question. And you could also see the Pharisees and the Sadducees, they also had questions. They had their arms crossed, their stuck-up nose up in the air, and they said, show us a miracle. Come on, dog. Come on. Jump up in here. Jump in this suit. Come on, do it for us. Didn't you see what I did at Capernaum? Didn't you see what I did in Galilee? Didn't you see what I did at the shore of the Sea of Galilee? Didn't you see all those things? No. You got to do it again. It's time to perform. Come on, bark on cue. Jesus said, you're not getting it. Jonah gave you enough sign that you ever need to see. And you're just like him. You're just as rebellious. So they didn't like that. But that just highlights this man coming to Jesus, if you are willing. He's saying, I believe you can. I'm just asking you, will you? I believe you have the power to take away what is incurable in the natural. If you are willing. That type of perspective was, I think, a very common understanding. They were in kings, the time of the kings and of potentates and of Caesars. You don't come to a king or a potentate and say, okay, here's my rights that I demand, do it for me. That's just not how you approach them. You asked, may I have this, may I have that. When they approached Pilate, they had to work with him. He was the authority. will you do this? Can you do this? And they manipulated the situation to get what they wanted, but they knew how to do it, to move his willingness. That's what it was all about. Are you willing to do this? So they're treating Jesus the same way. He's treating him with great respect. It's in your power. It's in your authority. Are you willing? You can make me clean. What a beautiful admonition. It's so sad so many others did not see this. The woman with the issue of blood, she saw this. If I can just touch you, I'm going to be healed. This man, if you're willing, I'm going to be clean. That's all it takes. Just your willingness to do this. The power is there. So that's a great question to start this off with. Jesus reveals who he is in the very next verse. It says Jesus moved with compassion. Now again, as we look at that word, well, was he not moved with compassion at other times? Yes, I certainly believe he was. I believe something was going on in his very human emotions and spirit, just like it would for us. He is moved with compassion. Something's going on between him and the Father that is now going to be demonstrated here in the physical. We tend to think, okay, of course, he is. He says here, I am willing, so he's willing at all times to do whatever we have in need of. Well, I have to challenge that a little, because if you look just a few verses up, when he went to the home of Simon and Andrew, the mother-in-law there, and after the sun had set, the whole city were gathered, and they were all sick too. There was many demons that came. And if you read back at verse 34, it says, he healed many who were sick. See something left out there? He didn't say all. He healed many. He healed many that were there. So does he not have compassion on the others? Yes. This is not a program for us to follow. This is a revelation of his heart. He's showing us who he is. He's Almighty God. With just a breath, the world can exist, and with another breath, we could cease to exist. He is awesome, and he is mighty beyond our comprehension. His least thing, the darkness, so to speak, of God, is more grand and glorious than we could possibly fathom or handle as human beings. He is the greatest of all, the Lord of all lords. Presidents are nothing but fodder to him. He is the Almighty God of creation. And so we look to him with great respect and with giving him great authority because of his might and his majesty. We don't look at him demanding of him. We look at him asking for his grace and his willingness. And if you look at the gods of the other people, they had the same type feelings, but not the same type response to their gods. You see, you come to Zeus, you better bring him a good gift. You come to the other Greek and Roman gods, you better bring the best of your household. You better do it again and again and again. And then maybe you'll get something from this God. You had to earn it. You had to impress them. You had to do something to get their attention to do that. This is revealing something about the God that is revealing himself to the Jews and ultimately to us as humanity. He is revealing who he is. It says he was moved with compassion. This is not a God who has no feelings. See, that's it. That's Zeus. Zeus didn't care. Zeus wanted to know what he could get out of you. Caesar didn't care. Pay your taxes. That's all he cared about. He didn't care about you. He just cared that you behaved yourself. And that's the way the Roman order was. There is a God who says, I have compassion on what you are going through. I feel what you feel. I am hurting while you're hurting. I know what you're going through. I'm not unmoved. I am moved with compassion for you. It's a radical concept that we become used to because our world has been baptized in Christian compassion. But this was not always so. It was absolutely not so in the first century. So we got to step out of our Christian world for a moment and know they did not expect the world to be nice. Just like the world says, it's evil out there. Bad things are going to happen. You just get over it. They expect bad to come. To know that there is a God over all that has compassion, it is still radical, even to this very day. But it's what it reveals about him. I have compassion on not just the kind of compassion that some people talk about. Some people got compassion, but get out of your face. You know what I'm saying? I'll give to you from afar, but don't get around me. No. It's kind of funny. It's a little political. I won't get too much more political, but it's interesting how many people wanted to be sanctuary cities for migrants until the migrants showed up. Then let's move them out. Why? I'm wonderful, and it could happen to any of us. I'm fine with having compassion on you as long as you're over there. Don't show up on my doorstep. Don't be in my yard. Don't mess up what I've got. That's not Jesus. That's our type of compassion. It's not Jesus. Why do I know that's not Jesus? Well, look at the next verse. He says, he not only was moved with compassion, Jesus stretched out his hand. Why did the writers point this? This is so offensive. This is going to make Jesus look bad. You touch the unclean. That makes you unclean. That's Jewish law. Why would the writers do this? Why would they paint Jesus in such a negative light? You touch lepers. That's not going to gain you followers. Why would you do it? The only reason to do it was because that's exactly what Jesus did. Jesus didn't follow the protocols. Jesus was moved with compassion, and he reached out and he grabbed hold of that leprous hand that was itching, that was sore-ridden, that was wasting away. He grabbed hold of him and said, I am willing for you to be clean. Be cleansed. Not only did he have compassion, he had power. That was the plan of God. God is willing to heal. God is moved with compassion. And he acts on that compassion. It says when he touched him, what happened? What happened? The leprosy. Now, I didn't know diseases had ears. How do you talk to a disease? I know I've heard of these people that talk to diseases and stuff, but that's kind of way out there. That's kind of weird Twilight Zone stuff right there. But look at the language. He spoke. Leprosy got up and moved.
I don't know how,
but I guess the God who created it all, he knows how to speak to it all. I don't understand how to talk to the cellular structure, but God does. I don't know how to talk to diseases, but God does. I don't know how to talk to the human heart to convince it, but God does. I don't understand these things. I'm just a creature, but God Almighty knows how to speak to all things. And Paul grasped hold of this concept. He says, you know what? Everything in this world that holds together, it holds together by the power of not some God, but his name is Jesus. He holds it all together. And let me tell you, 2,000 years later, we're still promising that the world's going to fall apart tomorrow, but it's still being held together, much to the disdain of scientists who said we already should be gone, but God says, I'm still holding it in the palm of my hand. The plan of God is greater than we can understand. But I want to talk about something else that he did here. Jesus revealed his heart and did his work. And he asked for something in return. He wanted him to do something for him. A lot of folk, unfortunately, my own heart has been this way at times. I want to worry about God, what are you going to do for me? Not really having a listening ear to what you want for me back. I just want you to take care of my issue so I can go on with life. But he, once he had healed him, he said these words, don't tell anyone. You mean the greatest thing that has ever happened in my life. The thing that is impossible. This can't happen. You're expecting me to say nothing to anyone about the miracle. Why? Do you see an answer to that why in that verse? See me after church if you do, because I don't see it. You know why? You don't see a why? It's not your business. It's not my business. He keeps the whys to himself. He just asks for obedience. Why, Jesus? Why would you do this? Don't know. He did this often. He told them not to say. He told the demons, don't speak my name. Why? I don't know. But that's what he said. And he expected obedience out of it. But he also said, not only obey me, but he says, I want your life. I want your life to be a testimony again. I don't want you to go around telling everybody, I was a leper, now I'm set free. I want you to go through the ritual that's in the law of Moses, and I want the priest to declare, this man is clean, this man is whole, and his very life is a testimony to something's happening in Israel. Something is manifesting itself in our midst. They could put two and two together. They weren't known. Let your life be a testimony. It is the push and the pull, isn't it? Anybody, come on, let's admit this. Anybody ever run into a door because you handled it wrong? Either you pushed when you should have pulled, or you pulled when you should have pushed. Well, I got a couple of cartoons for you. Let's have a good laugh on behalf of ourselves. So the first one, anybody who used to have Far Side, you could appreciate the humor. This is Minvale's School for the Gifted. The problem is he can't get in the door. Some of you might get that later, but you'll be all right. The next one for you who says, yes, that's so me. I know my soulmates out there. They're just pulling on the push door. Some of you can agree with that one too. You can understand. This is what's happening between us and God. The push. We want our plans, not always God's plans. And we as humans want them to be. Let me push that even further. We expect our plans to be His plans. Now, we don't mean to. I think it's just kind of natural for us because we fully believe we're right. How long do we fully believe we're right? Until we're shown to be wrong. And then we revise it real quick, and then we're right again. So we just kind of assume we're right. And of course God is going to agree with us. Until He doesn't. And that's the tough place. That's the hard place where we don't understand all things that He knows. But here's where we have to look at the plan of man versus the plan of God. The pushing when you should have been pulling and the pulling when you should have been pushing. He was willing to be well, wasn't he? Oh, I want to be well, and I have a belief to be well. I've got all that. I want that. He's begging for it. He's not just saying, if you got, if you got a moment in time, just come by. I know you can do it, no problem. No, he's begging. This is insistent. This is urgent. Yes, yes, I want to be well so badly. Once he received the healing, what happened? Jesus' words before the miracle were crucial to him. Jesus' words after the miracle were optional. What changed about Jesus' authority? Nothing except his belief about them. See, let me play in his mind for a minute. I can't be there, but I'm going to play anyway. Why would Jesus want to keep something so great from everybody else? Why would he want to hide how wonderful he is? Why would he not let me tell anybody? Of course, that's not what he means. Of course, he just must mean tell it to a few people. Because he can't mean to literally not tell anybody. Have you heard that before? Because I hear preachers still saying that. Well, that's not what it really means. Well, how do you really know? How do you? Again, we assume we know the mind of God. But that's not true at all. He said, this is ridiculous. I'm not going to do it. He was willing to disobey the one that healed him of the injury. Isn't that amazing of the human heart to say, I want your healing, but I don't want the life that you have for me to live. I don't want it. I want to live the life you've given to me in my way. It's very difficult to grapple with as humans, but we have to. I'm reading a book by Ginger Duggar right now that came out of a really almost cult-like status of a sect of Christianity. Christianity that absolutely dominated the entirety of her life. And for so many of her peers, it drove them away from Christ, and they never want to have anything to do with church again. It's very sad. She said, I could not do that. I couldn't walk away from my faith and Jesus, meaning the faith that she was brought up in. She said, I believed in Him. I had to untangle myself from some things I believed, and they were taught me and were pushed into me. But I can't leave Jesus. See, that's where we get mangled up and tangled up. We believe my will must be God's will. My way of seeing must be God's way. Beloved, we are not big enough to pull Him down. We're not wide enough to encompass God. We're not enough. He's greater, higher, better, more majestic, more beyond our understanding. He said it Himself. Your understanding down here, if you could reach the top of the sky, that's where I am. You don't understand. So, don't understand. Obey. He said to obey, and He said, nope. It says, immediately He went out and began to proclaim freely. Freely. He felt no inhibitions. He felt no guilt. He felt nothing for the one who healed him. He said, look at what happened to me. Look at what happened to me. Look at what happened to me. The plan of man did not line up with the plan of God. So what happened? He got a cure of the body, but he did not get a cure of the soul. Because a soul that won't obey the Jesus who healed them or saved them from destruction, that's not a saved person. That's a person who just wanted God to pad their life. It's a sad thing, but it's exactly what happened here. He was willing to be well, but he proclaimed what Jesus told him not to. So what happened? And again, this is absolutely miraculous. Not miraculous. This is a powerful scripture. It says, so that Jesus could no longer enter the city openly. He changed the ministry of Jesus. It sounds like from the scripture, he wanted to be able to go back into the cities. He wanted to minister there. But because of disobedience, he couldn't do something he wanted to do. He changed to the outskirts. And so now when we have all those pictures of him being in the wilderness and all the crowds crowded around him, it's because of this man who said, I will have my will over God's will. And of course it doesn't affect God. But God has coupled himself with humanity. He feels what we feel. He is working with us, not in spite of us. It's a thing that I think is very unfair to God. But it's his choice, not ours. You say, don't use me. Don't make me responsible. He says, you don't have a choice. You are mine. I've called you by name. We are tied together. If you sin, it hurts him. If you fail, it speaks to his name. And God forgive the church for how the church has blackened the name of Jesus Christ. It don't stick because it's not him. But you've still done it. We've still done it. All because the plan of God does not come up with the plan of man. Do we seek what he seeks for? Or is he simply the means to our own agenda? Is the question I'm believing. Is his agenda our agenda? Or are we seeking him for our own agenda? I want to share something with you. Because this is a tough season. Everybody's got a part they could add to this story. I'm quite sure. But Tim Keller, well-respected pastor I've learned a lot from, had a powerful ministry in New York City. COVID year, he got diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. And the doctor, he already had thyroid cancer back when he was 50, around 50, 51. Doctor said, Street, we're good. He says, when I walked into the doctor's office this time, he says, you're going to die. Bottom line, it's just how long it's going to take. For a pastor, it's kind of hard. So this podcast, if you have an opportunity, not only a podcast, but it's on YouTube, listen, watch the whole thing because it's really powerful. This is basically one of the last interviews that he had. So, I mean, you're talking about these are the last words he's going to say. And as a pastor, he's got a pastor's heart, and he will talk through this whole episode like a pastor. It's unbelievable, Tim Keller. But he's being asked all kinds of questions about his diagnosis. And what ministered to me so much And there's a couple of clips. I can't show you both of them because we're running on time. But I want to tell you one and show you another one, so it's short. But he said, what have you learned? The highs and the lows. And you can look for yourself if you want to see some of the lows. But he says, one of the highs is my prayer life has never been like it is now. He said, I used to think I knew how to pray. I used to thought I was a pretty good prayer. I know how to pray now. There's something about when the doctor says, you're dying. You're dying. Deal with it. But the other question that came up, is he's a pastor, evangelical pastor, who believes in healing. Are you still praying for healing? Are you still accepting God's sovereignty as the end and we can't do nothing about it? What are you doing as a pastor in real time? What are you doing? Are you just not praying anymore? Or you are praying and still believe with pancreatic cancer you can be healed? Here is his answer.
I mean, do you, yes. Have you kind of had people praying for healing for you too?
Yes.
How do you kind of, how do you square that theologically with the fact that obviously healing doesn't always happen?
Well, I pray, by the way, I would say at least twice a day, completely, even though my doctor told me there is no cure for pancreatic stage 4. Once it's out there, he will die of it. I pray for him. God can do it, or he doesn't have to do it. I mean, this is years and years of experience with him. When I look back on things that he did for me that at the time I thought were awful, but now I realize were actually good for me. I just, years of experience, I say, look, he knows. I mean, that may sound a little too easy.
He knows. See, I respect this pastor so much that he is in heaven now, where he wants to be with Jesus. But he said, through experience, I have learned that the things that I thought were bad, they turned out to be good. Why? Because he knows. And even in this, I pray for healing. It may not come. What do I do? He knows what's best, and I let him do it. What is the essence, is he saying? Not my will, but your will be done. Not my agenda. I mean, he says in here, man, I thought I would feel older. It's time to leave this. I thought I would feel like, yeah, my life's got over. I don't really feel that way. I just know I'm in God's hands. What a wonderful gift we have. This is how he feels, but he says, I'm in God's hands. It's about him. It's not about me. It's about his glory. It's not about my will. So we've obviously seen his will, but one of the scriptures, as you stand, please, with me, one of the scriptures he shared that was meaningful to him, I want to share with you. And I think this prayer from the Psalms, by the way, he loved having the Psalms for the past 2 years, the heights and the depths of emotion that are there, he has really lived off of strongly. Here's a prayer that he has been praying and living off of, and I think it is fantastic. And I think it really reveals a prayer that says, God, I want your glory to be revealed. And certainly I want it to be revealed through my needs, through my weaknesses, through what's going on in my life. But God, ultimately, I want you to get glory. I want you to do what you desire to do in this world. So here's the prayer. It comes from Psalms 91. He says, satisfy us in the morning with your unfailing love. I don't want anything in my day to have to come and satisfy me. I want your love to be enough for me. Beautiful, beautiful prayer. That we may sing for joy and be glad all our days. Make us glad for as many days as you have afflicted us, for as in many years as we have seen trouble. May your deeds be shown to your servants, your splendor to your children. May the favor of the Lord our God rest on us and establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. That's saying, God, everything I have is yours. My life is yours. Be glorified in it. And what do I need? I don't need money. I don't need fame. I just need your love to satisfy me. What a beautiful prayer, surrendering ultimately to God's will, making that our will. As we pray together, I want you to pray some version of that in your own heart. And if you can't, you need help, there's people can pray with you here at this altar. We want to. We want to get through this time together, what you're going through. But I want this song to be on our hearts, to be a part of who we are and what we're going through. This is the work of God, and there's no easy answers. But can I tell you, God has shown enough goodness. He's not going to leave you out. He's not going to exclude you. He's including you, but just not in the ways that you may be expecting. Trust in the compassion, the goodness, and the love of God, and trust in the will of God. If you need to come to the altar, please come, but let us all bow for prayer. Jesus, the miracle was obvious. It was open, powerful. But God, what strikes my heart more is how you put your emotions behind it. You were moved with compassion, and you moved with compassion. And you said, I am willing. Now, God, at times we've seen that willingness, and we praise you for it, and we glory in that. But God, I'm not crossing off your compassion when everything doesn't work out as we think it should. Because as this story highlights, doing your work our way is really disastrous. It does not produce the end that you desire. So God, I want us and whatever we're going through and whatever ups or downs we're struggling with, I want it to be of glory to God, and I want our life to be purposeful. I don't want anything to be wasted. I want everything to be used for our good and your glory. And I believe you will do that. I believe you will do that, God. With all my heart, I believe you love us, have compassion on us. We have a high priest who is not unaffected by our afflictions. He is well touched with the feelings of our infirmity. And even our sins, he's felt them, but he can deliver us from them because he's never given in to them. So God, you are our ultimate help, you're our ultimate hope, and we can pour it all out to you, and we can say, God, here I am. So Father, let us do that. Let us believe like Pastor Keller. You know. Maybe I don't understand right now. Maybe I don't understand why your agenda is not my agenda. I just don't understand that, God. But may we fall back on where he fell back on. You know. And either we trust that you know and are working good, or we don't. And that doesn't always come instantly. Sometimes it comes through struggle. He calls himself a skeptical man. And he says, I can't point to one thing that has shown undeniable proof of your goodness and existence. But he said, there's been a culmination of things all my life. Oh, God is real. God is true. And God is the ultimate of all. So, Lord Jesus, teach our hearts today that this room is now filled with testifiers of the goodness of God. Through the mountaintops and through the valleys, we testify God is good. That we may be conformed to your image, bound by your agenda, and what Jesus wants, hallelujah, what Jesus wants is what your church does. Grant this, my Father. Grant this in all of us. And let nobody in this room feel I can't be used, because that's a lie. My God is moved with compassion for us all. My God is willing to touch and use us all. That is your character. So God, we trust in that, and we're going to act in that. And we give you glory for the things that we know, and dear God, for the rest, we trust you. We thank you and honor you this day in the name of Jesus Christ. As we go today, remember to encourage one another. That smile, that hug, that good handshake means you love them. You appreciate them being there. So let's make it our goal right now. Can't wait 5 minutes from now. Too late. Right now. You got to do it right now. Make sure nobody leaves this place without somebody touching them with love in Jesus' name. And if you'll do it, give me an amen.
Amen.
Amen. Brother Steve, would you dismiss us with a prayer, sir? May God bless you and go with you.